one of the true reigning comedic geniuses in this country, Stan Freberg. I might tell you that on May 1st of last year, a commendation to Mr. Freberg, hailing him as a genius and satirist and comic minds of our time, from Congressman Mel Levine of California, was read into the Congressional Record. He may be the only advertising man in the Congressional Record.
Well,
for good things.
for good things. I'm sure other advertising people have been maligned from time to time.
Why did you leave the world of show business to go into advertising?
Well,
we all miss you in the regular world.
Yeah, I didn't have in mind that I was going to leave it all that much, actually. What happened was I became so successful, moving products, using humor, and trying new approaches to marketing and so forth, that I just became both enamored and excited about doing that because it was a new kind of thing. I was really breaking new ground when I did this, you know, in the late 50s. And
so you sort of fell into it?
Fell into it, yeah. Last March I was on Good Morning America, and David Hartman, was nice enough to say that I was the man who first legitimized the use of humor in advertising, which is to mean I made it safe for advertisers to kid around with the product because it worked. If you do it right, it works.
Why up to then had they resisted it?
Well, probably a combination of things. Maybe somebody who really understood how humor is constructed wasn't doing that work. You know, a humorous commercial, as far as I'm concerned, is built just like a Neil Simon play, as a beginning, a middle, and an end. And you have to remember to get the name of the client pretty close to the end so people remembered what it is they're supposed to go and look for. What kind of prunes? Oh, Sunsweet. They're right. If they don't remember that, then you've blown it. Advertising isn't even an art form to me unless it solves some marketing problem. There's no other excuse for somebody advertising, right?
What happened to you, though, in the world of records?
Okay.
I mean, you did some of the great satirical records of all time, St. George and the Dragon and Belafonte and that History of America, which was one of the great recorders. I mean, what happened to that?
Well, I just got here. One of the interesting things that happened was that adults stopped buying single records, it's true. And so the satire that I was doing was not all that intellectual necessarily, but it was sort of adult humor. And an unsophisticated 11, 12-year-old kid who was buying the Beatles and so forth really wasn't quite sophisticated enough to understand my satires, or they read into it that I was just putting these people down. So that my audience, which was mainly adults, gravitated to albums rather than singles. So now it became an enormous task for me. You know, it really wasn't. Looking back, I mean, I could have done it, but I was busy with advertising. But it was a task to put down 12 new singles. You know, okay, one on Rod Stewart. Okay, that's one side. Okay. And now, by the time you get to four, the first three records have fallen off the charts. It became a very difficult thing. I had to have such migraine headaches from it all that I just continued to do advertising. But in the meantime, a cult following
really developed
mainly on my album about the United States of America.
Which was going to be a Broadway show, right?
Yes, and it may still be a Broadway show.
I've been hearing that for years.
I know that, but now I was in Florida doing a series of shows for IBM with Walter Cronkite last month. That was a marvelous experience. Anyhow, a producer in Florida who owns 12 theaters, including the Chicago Theater that he's just been refurbishing. Zev Buffman is his name.
Know Zev very well.
Yeah, do you? And he said, I wanted to do this for 20 years. Please let me do this at Broadway musical. So we're talking about doing that.
We will give you an example now of the talent of Stan Freberg from the old days. And this was a commercial he did for Coca-Cola, right? With the Friedel family.
The Friedel family singers. But look, before you play that, I just want to say that at the time, The Sound of Music was out. So I thought, what if I created a musical group of family singers somewhere in between the Trapp family and the Mormon Tabernacle Choir? And this is what they would sound like, 104 voices and a canary, and I'm playing the part of Edward R. Murrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Stan Freberg and the Friedel Family Singers.
Good evening, Mr. Friedel.
Good evening, Ed. Well, we have the whole family here around the organ. My wife, Emily, our 24 children, 64 grandchildren, and 16 great-grandchildren.
Quite a family. I understand everyone sings.
Oh, yes. We get together every Sunday afternoon. 104 voices, all told.
What kind?
105, counting the canary.
Yes. What kind of songs do you sing?
Well, the old hymns, folk songs, madrigals.
Mm-hmm.
We just made up a cantata of a king-size Coca-Cola.
Would you sing it for us?
Love to. We call it Drink Big.
Fine.
Ready, everybody? Keep your eye on Grandpa.
Drink big. This is Coca-Cola. This is Coca-Cola. Drink big. This is Coca-Cola. This is Coca-Cola. Drink big, drink big king-size Coca-Cola. It costs no more.
A simple American family around the family organ. Good night. And good luck.
Here, the canary, Ed.
Stan Freberg. Tomorrow at at the NAB, they're going to be the major radio luncheon, at which time Stan Freberg will unveil a new campaign for broadcasting, for radio in particular. He's done some tremendous things in the past, which you know. And before he unveils it for the broadcasters tomorrow, we're going to unveil it for America tonight. We'll be back with the brilliant Stan Freberg on Larry King in Dallas. That's what we're calling this tonight, right? Larry King, I got to check with Tonto. What are we calling this?
King Does Dallas.
King Does Dallas. X-rated radio. We'll be back after these messages.
Live from Dallas and the National Association of Broadcasters Convention, it's the Larry King Show. Here again, Larry King.
Our guest, ooh, sound like I'm in a subterranean cellar, George, down a little. Our guest is the great Stan Freberg. Mel Allen, still to come. Stan, of course, is it your own agency?
Yes, I have, it's really a consulting firm. I consult two advertising agencies, mostly to clients. Mostly I'm hired by clients who have a marketing problem to solve.
And you do the whole campaign, or sometimes work with agencies?
I work sometimes with agencies, but mostly they let me do my thing because that's what they come to me for. My wife, by the way, is a brilliant woman, Donna Freberg. She's my producer, was for years my associate producer. I said, hey, listen, she's producing me. So now she's just my producer, I call her, because she's the smartest person that I know. She also is a very fine editor, edits my material after I write it, and works with me in the studio to edit it.
You know, it's always a great honor to meet people you've admired for a long time. And when I heard that you liked this show, that drove me crazy because I am a fan of yours from the word go.
Well, may I tell you something, Mr. King, sir? I am a tremendous fan of yours. I watch you all the time on CNN, and I listen to you on Mutual. I think, really, I'm not just saying this. You know me, I'm a straightforward guy. I wouldn't just say something like this. I think you are the best interviewer that I ever heard of in my life. I think you're the best. You're the best. Right? And it's really very simple. The reason you're so good at it is because you listen to the person that you're interviewing.
What'd you say? All right, we're going to do something here, folks. We're going to play now. We all know Stan Freberg's Stretching the Imagination. That's the famous maraschino cherry, what radio can do. Now, I understand you've updated that in stereo.
Well, I made it in stereo, and I upgraded the size of the monitor, which from 21 inches to 27 inches, because for the last 15 years it sort of bothered me that I said up to 21 inches, yes. By the way, when I made this spot, we didn't have multi-track. You understand? There's no 24-track. There wasn't even 8-track. So what we had to do is I had a different sound on each Ampex machine, and I had 7 Ampexes lined up, all going into the 8th Ampex, and I'd run alongside the engineer, tapping him on the shoulder when I wanted him to hit the start button. 4 times, you know, 4 machines in, he'd blow it, back everything up to the leaders, and start over. The master take of this, which is still the master, I only put it through stereo, through the board, but it really is the master, and it's take 72. My wife and I produced this.
Okay, this is one of the, maybe the greatest radio spot ever produced. And in a moment, we're going to hear the new one, which no one has heard yet. This is an updated version in stereo with a slightly different ending. Here is Stan Freberg's classic, Stretching the Imagination.
Radio? Why should I advertise on radio? There's nothing to look at, no pictures.
Listen, you can do things on radio you couldn't possibly do on TV.
That'll be the day.
All right, watch this. Okay, people, and now when I give you the cue, I want the 700-foot mountain of whipped cream to roll into Lake Michigan, which has been drained and filled with hot chocolate. Then the Royal Canadian Air Force will fly overhead towing a 10-ton maraschino cherry, which will be dropped into the whipped cream to the cheering of 25,000 extras. All right, cue the mountain. Okay, 25,000 cheering extras.
Now, you want to try that on television?
Well...
You see, radio is a very special medium because it stretches the imagination.
Doesn't television stretch the imagination?
Up to 27 inches, yes.
Presented by the National Association of Broadcasters.
The classic Stretching the Imagination. Stan Freberg.
Thank you.
Now, we are in a moment going to hear your next one.
Okay.
Would you tell us, this has never been heard, folks. This is for the National Association of Broadcasters. Tell us what it's about.
Okay. What it really is, you know, we've called radio for years the theater of the mind, at least I have, because that's what radio is. So I thought, well, what if I just sort of wander around inside my own mind? And I asked my 14-year-old son, Donovan Freberg, to join me. He's a very fine young actor. He used to be the voice of Charlie Brown when he was younger. And so he is with me in stereo on this little excursion into my mind. And why don't you just play it and you'll see what happens.
All right, this is brand new. It'll be played tomorrow at this convention. You'll be hearing it on radio stations and radio networks all across America. But this is a first ever for the National Association of Broadcasters. Shh! Stan Freberg's Theater of the Mind.
I'm just sort of walking around here inside the theater of my mind.
How did I get in here?
I put you in here. That's the nice thing about radio. I can put anything I want in here. Watch out for those elephants.
That was close. Watch yourself. You almost stepped in front of that train.
I saw it coming, actually.
Is that a merry-go-round over there by those Inca ruins?
Yes, it is.
Well, what do you mean that's the nice thing about radio?
Well, unlike, say, TV, which is at the mercy of the size of the screen, you know, the monitor of our head is limitless.
I get it.
Like that giant pterodactyl over there taking a bite out of the Superdome.
That's neat.
Send the synthesizer players in, will you?
Come on in. Thanks for helping me reappreciate radio. I gotta play this back on my Walkman.
Excuse me?
Yeah?
You left the door to my mind open.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Presented by the National Association of Broadcasters.
Stan Freberg's Theater of the Mind. You'll be hearing... That is just...
Thank you. It's kind of a weird spot, isn't it?
Yeah. How did you...
Sort of like the inside of my head, actually.
How long to conceive that, or is it impossible to explain?
No, actually, once I decided I wanted to go inside of my head, I just sat down at the typewriter. It really wrote itself in a couple of hours' time.
Really?
Yeah, really. Yeah.
Was that the first decision you made, Theater of the Mind, or were you kicking other
things? No, I kicked it around. That's the thing, is that I sometimes kick ideas around for weeks, you know, but once I settle on something, then it usually writes itself pretty fast. Interestingly enough, after I said, like that pterodactyl over there taking a bite out of the Superdome, and then I had a line where my son said, or that Middle Eastern war winding down over there, and then it had, there's the sound of a war winding down. It went, bum, 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 you know? So anyhow, we decided, I don't know, it's a downer, you think about that, especially tonight.
Yeah.
I'm glad I didn't put that in there, but also... It was too long. It made it a minute eight, and you can't put a minute eight commercial on the air. So
is it hard to think for a satirist who has done things broadly your famous records, that album, to think in terms of 60 and 30 seconds?
No, I really trained my mind to work that way over the years. I mean, you have to, you know, that's it. They got this computer over at NBC or Mutual or wherever, it just goes wacko, you know? And that's boy. And when the 60 seconds is up, you're off, folks.
But I've had Sammy Kahn and Alan J. Lerner tell me that the art of doing commercials is a totally separate art from their art because it's very hard to do something briefly.
You have to work within the boundaries of the medium, and that's right. I had Billy Wilder, who was a friend of mine, the great film director, looked at a minute commercial I did one time for Gino's Pizza with the Lone Ranger and Tonto and 100 extras, and he says to me, "Ah, how can you work this way? I don't understand. This is brilliant. I couldn't do this." He says, "What?" I said, "I still have to take a second out of here." He says, "What's the difference? Who cares?" I said, "No, I got to get a second out of this thing. You know, standing over the moviola, and you got to get it out. That's all."
Was the Chun King the thing that made you commercially?
That was probably the first. Yeah, that was the first really successful thing I did for my old friend Jeno Pellucci, who. Nobody had heard of the Chun King Company till I started doing the commercials, and then after about three, actually, he thought this stuff wouldn't work, you know, and 3 months after they went on the air, he said, well, he had bet me that if it worked, he would pull me in a rickshaw up La Cienega in Los Angeles, and after about 4 months, sales were up 40%. Came out, rented a rickshaw, and said, "Get in." You know, the guy pulled me for like 8 blocks. I thought I was going to have a heart attack. So he spun that off, Chun King, to Reynolds Tobacco for $64 million cash. Then he took that and started Gino's Pizza. And last year he sold that to Pillsbury for about $180 million. And Forbes now lists him as having a personal wealth of about $500 million. You see what can happen to a man who okays some funny commercials?
If not for you, you made him.
Well,
can you do funny commercials for any client?
No. I've turned down Forest Lawn repeatedly over the years. No, it's true.
They wanted funny commercials?
Yes, they did. There's a man, to this day, I think he called about 6 months ago. I said, no, there's nothing funny about death, you know. Especially to the person that just died. And
what about other types? Are there other types?
You know, I've turned down cigarette commercials. I was turning cigarette companies down before it was fashionable, actually.
Are there other types that you can't be funny with?
Well, I turned down a woman's bra company because I didn't know how to do that and be in good taste, you know. Hollywood Vassarette Company. Beat
really?
On my door for years, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, you know, I just didn't know how to do that and be tasteful and not.
Do you do a lot of local commercials, too, banks and
not stuff? Necessarily, but I will. I'm just now, as we speak, in Los Angeles, there's a regional commercial for the West Coast for a new potato chip called Ma Bell's Potato Chip.
What did they you found do for them?
Oh, I did a satire on, the guy says, announcing Ma Bell's original full-strength potato chip. And I said to him, I had the next line, I said, "That's just what the world needs, all right, another potato chip, you know."
And
that, you know, that causes blood to drain out of the faces of a company, you know. They didn't know I was going to do anything that wild. You know? But the bottom line is they okayed it and went on the air and is selling potato chips on the West Coast, you know.
Our guest is Stan Freberg. We're going to pause for news headlines, a word from local stations. Then what we're going to do is that we'll intersperse some phone calls, but we'll let the people here in the Westwood One Mutual Suite ask any question they wish of Stan Freberg, sort of like a press conference. And we'll come back, and then later we'll meet Mel Allen.
Can I say one thing?
Yes.
Before he goes to sleep,
I got to take a break, and you'll say it right after. Hold on for his family. I'm Larry King, and this is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Listening to The Larry King Show, live from Dallas and the National Association of Broadcasters Convention. And now, here's Larry.
Little Dallas theme. Sharp, sharp, back at the web.
Oh, yeah.
Little Freberg steel there. This is Larry King. We're broadcasting from the Westwood One Mutual Suite. First, we're going to take a call, and then we'll take some questions from the audience here. Our guest is Stan Freberg, and we go to Seattle. Hello.
Hello. I had a quick question for you.
Sure.
Yes.
Is there any place in the room right here that you're going to be at Seattle, and if, what are you going to be doing?
Yes, I'll. There is truth to the rumor. I'll be in Seattle Thursday. I'll be emceeing a black tie affair for the Puget Sound Broadcasters, I think they're called, up in the top of the Sheraton Hotel there.
Oh, probably not open, but some broadcaster come and see it.
Sure. I think that if there's any seats left, they'll be glad to sell you a ticket or
tell
whatever.
What you do, sir. Tell them you spoke to Stan.
Go to the dinner, right? Yeah, that's right. Tell him I said it was okay to charge your ticket to the president of the Puget Sound Broadcast.
That's right. And anybody else in Seattle listening that wants to go see Stan, Thursday night?
If you want to order any room service while you're there, you can also charge that off to him.
Okay. That's the Sheraton?
That's Thursday.
Okay.
Thursday night at the Sheraton.
All right, if you're listening in Seattle, Thursday night at the Sheraton, Stan's invited all of you. Just tell him you're guests of the Puget Sound Broadcaster. If you order any food, charge it to the Puget Sound Broadcasters.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
The guy buys it, right? Okay. Young, beautiful lady here.
Thank you. I'm Barbara Griffith with KXAS, the NBC affiliate here. Mr. Freberg, I'd like to know, do you ever do any political advertising?
Only once. I worked for Senators George McGovern and Mark Hatfield when they were trying to legislate us out of Vietnam. They thought they had a very brilliant idea that if all the money was cut off to Southeast Asia, then we couldn't have a war there without money. And it almost made it. Anyhow, they hired me to do some political announcements that played in those states where the senators were the congressmen also were on the fence, didn't know which way to go. And I was responsible for getting quite a few votes, but not quite enough. It was defeated by only 7 votes, I think.
Would you represent a candidate in a political race?
I might if I believed them in him enough.
You couldn't represent someone you didn't believe in?
Oh, absolutely not. Any more than I could represent some food or you know.
You must like every product you do.
I do. Yes, I do.
Gentleman here.
Hi, Stan.
Yes.
I was wondering if there was ever a time where you thought you had a Clio winner, really poured your heart and soul into the commercial, and it never got on the air.
No, I haven't had any experience where it didn't get on the air, but I entered a commercial in the Clios this last year, and I haven't heard back from them yet, so maybe it didn't win a Clio, but I think it's one of the best commercials I ever did.
Which was it?
It was a commercial which caused Prince the Rock Star to almost have a heart attack. It was for Prince Spaghetti, a company in Boston that's been in business since 1912.
What did you do?
It came on just like a rock concert with all, you know, from a long shot way up in the balcony. You see the smoke coming up and the ready lights are going and the music, rock music hits. And I say, ladies and gentlemen, in concert, Prince. And the word Prince comes up into the screen. And then I cut to the audience and there's like 100,000 kids screaming and going ape, you know. And then I whip the camera to the stage. There's nothing there but a box of Prince spaghetti. And then a voice, was also my son, played this kid, that says, oh, that Prince. I says, well, what do you mean in concert? I said, in concert with your Prince spaghetti sauce. And we cut to a shot of the sauce pouring over the spaghetti. Then I cut to the box and the jar, and a lace-gloved hand comes in for a moment and puts the jar down. There was a little microphone. It was about 3 inches high. It was a very subtle thing, like the spaghetti was getting ready to sing any moment. Anyhow, and then the last line was, Prince, the original. Anyhow.
That's
so,
your work, clear. Did they get mad?
The Prince Company in Boston, after okaying this and it was on the air, played for about 2 weeks on the air, suddenly they get a letter from Prince, the rock star's lawyer, saying, please cease and desist using our client's name on your box of spaghetti. Kidding or what? So, Anyhow, so I wrote them back and said, you better notify Walt Disney, who's getting ready to reissue Snow White, and tell them they have to rename one of the central characters to Blank Charming. Anyhow, in the end, Prince, the rock star, found his sense of humor, evidently, and backed off from the lawsuit, and it was very successful. Commercial was funny, sold a lot of spaghetti, but so far I haven't heard back from the Clio Awards. But so I have a few Clios of my own already, so it doesn't matter much.
Stan Freeberg, a lady right here.
Hi, Stan. Lorraine Thomas. I teach a broadcast advertising course and was wondering about 15-second commercials, if you could successfully make fun of a product in 15 seconds.
I think that the 15-second commercial is one of the worst ideas since the Edsel. I really think it's a terrible idea. I may comment on this tomorrow at the National Association of Broadcasters luncheon where I'm speaking.
Why is it a terrible idea, Stan?
Well, because there already is enough proliferation of commercial messages so that the whole thing is any moment. Now, I'm talking about radio as well as television. It has become, advertising in this country has become what I have called audiovisual wallpaper. People see it, but they don't see it. They hear it, but they don't hear it. It becomes more and more difficult to get the message through. I say people have developed from being beat over the head and about the ears with hard sell all these years. I've said people have developed a cauliflower receptivity, and it becomes very difficult to get the message through the scar tissue. 60 seconds is tough enough to hold somebody's attention. 30 is the borderline. Now, 15 seconds, okay? If 15 seconds is a great idea, what's wrong with 7.5, right? Any moment now, we're going to be, you know, up to our wazoos in 7.5-second commercials. I just think that that was an idea developed not by a creative man, but somebody in a network with a slide rule who never had to slide paper into a typewriter in his life and create anything that would communicate in 30 seconds even. And said, well, look here, that breaks down to, hey, we cut in the middle, we can sell it to two different sponsors, make two commercials where one existed. It's sort of like sausage, grinding out sausage, you know. But they're just smaller sausages, that's
all. Have you dealt with a lot of folks like that in the business?
Oh, of course. I mean, those, you know, I have to deal with those kind of advertising people.
How do they get to positions of prominence, do you think?
Well, you mean within an advertising agency?
Within an agency or within a network?
A lot of times their father started the agency.
Our guest is Stan Freberg, and we'll be back after these messages.
Live from Dallas and the National Association of Broadcasters Convention, it's the Larry King Show. Again, Larry King.
We're at the convention of the National Association of Broadcasters. Our guest is Stan Freberg. Before we take a call, Stan wants to say something to his father.
Hi, Dad. My dad, Reverend Victor Freberg in Pasadena, California, is 87 years old, listens to you constantly. And he said to me, really? Are you really going to be on Larry King? Gee, that's... Finally, I impressed him.
We go to Cleveland, Ohio. Hello.
Oh, I got a question for Stan Fever. Do you think it's harder to be a comedian than be a satirist? Or take more talent to be a...
Good question. What's more difficult, satire or comedy?
Oh, satire is infinitely more difficult because,
the
first
joke
of all,
is it closes on Saturday night, right? yeah, satire.
Yeah, well, that's, I'm not so sure it closes on Saturday night. I've been doing it all these years, and I haven't closed yet.
No, but I mean, I meant that from the point of difficulty.
No, I know.
To pull it off.
Yeah, you're right. Here's the point, that there's no way you can just say... starting tomorrow morning, I'm going to be a satirist. I mean, satirists are really made that way. I mean, they by the time they got to be adult people, they looked at the world through a satirist's glasses. My best friend is Ray Bradbury, the writer. Has he been on your show?
Twice.
Oh,
terrific.
Marvelous, marvelous man. And he and I are both great radio buffs, you know, because we grew up listening to radio and we're influenced by radio more than any other medium. Anyhow, and Ray is on fire to say the things that he says, and satirists, whether it's Art Buchwald or Oliphant, the great political cartoonist, and many of the other cartoonists, Herb Bloch, and anyhow, these people really feel very strongly about what it is they want to say, and getting up on a soapbox would be the easiest thing of all, but that's just preachmen, and people don't want to be preached to, particularly in political satire or other social issues. So the hard part, I've said, comes in putting a candy coating of humor over the whole thing, which makes it the pill go down easier. Like yes. I did with Green Christmas. I was enraged for years about the over-commercialization of Christmas, but nobody wants to listen to an enraged man, you know. I mean, they can tune in Jerry Falwell or if they want to hear that or whatever.
So you did that brilliant Green Christmas.
Green Christmas.
Do satirists think funny?
Well, hopefully.
I mean, or rather than... Some people say they see things funny or see funny things.
Yes, they do see things funny.
In other words, when you're watching normal television...
Yes, no, I'm laughing when no one else is laughing.
That's right.
On the
so
airplane,
you might watch an anchor and an anchor woman, and you might be thinking
right.
how I would satirize that, right?
Yes. Flying in today from Los Angeles on American Airlines, they have now, instead of, they used to have live stewardesses that did this a little performance showing you how to,
right.
you know, fasten
now they have it
belt.
On tape.
Now they got it on videotape. Sometimes the videotape runs down. It goes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, yeah. Anyhow, but now this woman is showing how the bottom of your seat becomes a flotation object. And you strap it around. She's smiling, boy. All 32 teeth are smiling. And she shows how to blow it up. If if it doesn't inflate with these two rings you pull, then you have a little thing you blow into on either side. And we hope you have a really nice day and fly American some other time. I'm the only guy that's laughing. That's hilarious. I mean, what a segue, right? Man, Tim. The only thing would have been funnier if she said, in case the rings don't work and you're floundering around in the water, then you could blow on these little tubes. And we hope you have a nice flight and fly American, you know? Okay.
Gentlemen here.
I was the only person laughing on the airplane. I laughed out loud. I looked around in embarrassment. I was the only person laughing. So that shows.
That's the satirical mind.
For the 4,000th time, I'm the only person in an audience laughing. Yes.
Question from mutual affiliate KYSM Mankato, Minnesota.
Yes.
How do you keep your creativity charged up over the years? And also, Larry, do you think the twins have a chance?
I don't know if we should combine questions like that. I mean,
anyone in the American League West has a chance, I think. Okay, go ahead, Stan. How do you keep the creativity juices going?
Well, the idea is that you're supposed to feed the well. I mean, you can't have everything going out. You have to. But for example, just before I left, even though I hadn't finished the speech, and I still, as I sit here tonight, have not finished writing what I'm going to say tomorrow. I still took time out with my son and his friend to see a marvelously satirical film called Brazil, which was done by Terry Gilliam and Monty Python. Oh, really? Far out, yeah.
Far out.
And it was I found it very, very...
strange.
Mentally strange, to say the least, but mentally stimulating. You know, you have to have stimulus. That's why I'm an information junkie. I read about four newspapers every day, and sorry to mention the other medium here, but... Anyhow, I read, books, magazines, everything I get my hands on, you know. I read the backs of labels and on packages. goes into my random access disk up there in the head. You know?
We'll be back with our remaining moments with Stan Freberg after this message.
Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys.
Live from Dallas and the National Association of Broadcasters Convention, it's the Larry King Show. Here again, Larry King.
Our guest is Stan Freberg at the top of the hour, Mel Allen. We're coming to you from the Lowe's Anatole in Dallas, from the Westwood One Mutual Suite. Gentlemen here.
Were you influenced by people like Henry Morgan?
Yes, I was, as a matter of fact. And when I was 18 years old, I was a guest on the Henry Morgan radio show. And that was a great experience. I started in radio when I was about 17, But I was more influenced, actually, by Fred Allen. Fred Allen, Jack Benny, and Norman Corwin were the three people that influenced me most in radio.
Really, those three?
Those three people, yeah.
Gentlemen here.
Hi, David Watrous from Arcadia, California. I'm now for radio station, but I'd like to sometime. I was wondering what your favorite experience is as far as either speaking or otherwise that you've had over your long career.
Favorite experience? How do you mean that, sir? I mean, it's personal.
Weird. How about most question. Embarrassing experience? How's that? For a
no, let's not get into that.
I'll follow up on that. Stan has had one famous failure that I know of. An airline campaign in which I thought was brilliant, in which you pitched fear. You told passengers they were afraid of flying and not to be afraid. That failed, right?
No, it actually didn't fail. I hate to correct you after all the nice things I've said about you. But
what did happen?
It appeared to fail. It was something that appeared to fail. I'm writing a book for Random House, by the way. And I have a whole chapter on this. And here's what I'll just try to tell you quickly. The airline that is now called Hughes Air West was the airline that I worked for. It was called Pacific Airlines. Okay. It turned out that they were afraid they were going to be left out of this merger, which became Hughes Air West. But they didn't bother to tell me this. I just thought they wanted to keep doing this for the next 3 or 4 years, you know. And instead, they wanted to become notorious overnight. And they were. This ad that I ran in the New York Times, Huntley Brinkley held it up on the air, you know, and the camera moved in on it, and they'd know the airline didn't have to pay for the time. The headline was, "Hey there, you with the sweat in your palms," you know, because I figured that all of the airline business was at that point divided up among about 30% of the American public. And all they did is proselyte passengers from United. Then they got them on over in American, and American grabbed people from TWA and so forth. Everybody was ignoring the 70% of the public that did not fly. Okay, so assuming that some of those were babies, some were old people infirm in wheelchairs or whatever, or people that just didn't have the money, there must have been a substantial group of people that didn't fly for what reason? Because they were afraid to fly. So I decided to address this campaign to those people who had sweaty palms about flying. The campaign was enormously successful. They started a new route, and they owned the first week. This airline from Burbank to San Francisco, they had 12 people on a 727. 3 weeks later, after this campaign, within 3 weeks, I'd filled the airplanes. Really, it was a tremendous... So now what happened was they did get included in the merger because Time, Newsweek, AP, UPI, all these people did the stories. I made an invisible airline become visible.
But why was it called a failure?
Because a guy at the AP, really, I should have sued the AP at the time. He didn't understand. What happened was this merger took place, and so then they said, no, we don't need these commercials anymore. We were included in the merger, and they dumped the campaign. So this guy at AP writes a headline. You know, it's like somebody reviews a book, never even read the book.
Yeah.
Okay, this guy didn't even listen to the campaign. So he wrote this headline, Airlines merge, sweaty palms campaign flops. Airline forced to merge. They weren't forced to merge.
They wanted to merge.
To death to be in the merger.
And it didn't flop.
It did not flop. I'm explaining this more. Now that I've told it on the Larry King Show, I don't have to bother to write this in my Random House book.
Gentlemen there.
But Stan, Marty Larson from WNCO, the mutual affiliate in Ashland, Ohio. How long does it take for an advertising campaign like yours to get momentum and get rolling and results for the sponsor? And once they get the results, how long should they use the campaign? Because a lot of times in a small market, when something works, the guy's heard it. Okay. He says, that's great, but I want something different.
All right. Let me tell you this. It all depends on the amount of media that's bought. As far as I'm concerned, in advertising, the creative idea in the commercial is the locomotive and the media is the rails. Without the rails, the train is not going anywhere. So if they don't buy enough media, that is enough spots, exposures on the radio or television, then it'll take longer to build a successful campaign. If they buy it correctly, the way I usually try and advise clients, you know, I can make people aware of a brand new product in 3 weeks in a given city or across America, you know. But I think that if it has that much really heavy exposure that probably after 6 weeks they ought to retire that and move on to the next commercial.
Yeah, but 6 weeks is about the right time. Yet some commercials will run a year.
That's because the people running them don't understand anything about communication.
You should not run a commercial a year.
Oh, of course not. It's terrible. Even if it's a, if it's not a funny commercial, or it becomes irritating after a while to see the same thing, no matter how nice the photography is or whatever. That's enough already of that. People should move on to the next thing.
What's the funniest?
It would be like playing the same Larry King show, night after night after night after night after night. No, 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 no. No matter how scintillating this show, for example, tonight, if we ran this for 4 weeks, people would be throwing stones at Mutual.
What's the funniest commercial you've heard you didn't do?
Let me see. I saw a Midas commercial one time, and I wrote a fan letter to the guy at the Wells Rich and Green that created it, and in return for that, he actually hired me to do some commercials. But it was a Midas commercial, in which the woman says to the man, "You should have gone to Midas," and he says, "I should have gone to Midas," and she says, "Why didn't you?" And the camera moves down his face, and he just gives this big shrug. Fade out. It was great. And then he didn't even cut to the name Midas. It was brilliant, you know.
That is terrific use of the medium.
Right, absolutely.
To keep you remembering something that you remember all the time.
I remembered that for years, yeah. You know, it was about five years ago.
Did you like the Stiller and Mara Blue Nun?
Yes, I like that. Those are very talented people. I've known them for years. And Jerry and Man.
You're an incredible credit to the industry of humor, not just commercials. It's been an honor meeting you.
Thank you.
Your
Thank
father
you,
should be proud of you.
He is, actually. He is. My dad really is proud of me.
We love and this campaign.
Thank you.
And, everyone will be at the luncheon tomorrow.
Good. And I want to say, once again, it's really a pleasure being on your show because you're the best interviewer in the world, I think, really. Because you listen and because you're a good, intelligent interviewer.
Stan Freberg, ladies and gentlemen, and we have the honor tonight of presenting for the first time on the radio something you'll be hearing for at least 6 weeks, if they do it right, on network radio and stations across America, the first ever airing tonight of Theater of the Mind, a perfect follow-up to the previous Stretching the Imagination campaign. Our guest is Stan Freberg. We're going to pause now for news on the hour, a word from your local stations, and be back with Mel Allen. Can you do a 15-second quickie on this show? A little satire on this show. Stan Freberg is with us, and we thank him very much for being our guest in the first hour. Then coming Mel Allen, and then Eddie Fritz, the president of the National Association of Broadcasters, and Ted Snyder, the joint board chairman of the NAB. Tomorrow night, Richard Marcus, chairman of Neiman Marcus, will be here, the major department store based in Dallas. Shelby Coffey, formerly the Washington Post, now editor of the Dallas Times-Herald. And also from the world of broadcasting, Dwight Case of Radio and Records and Ron Aldridge of Electronic Media. We will have other surprises as well as we find them drifting around the convention center. We'll pause now for news on the hour, a word from your local stations, and be back with Mel Allen. This is Larry King in Dallas at the NAB, and this is the Mutual Broadcasting System.